Welcome to using SQL to wrangle data in the R programming language with SQLDF. My name is Brian Kafferke, and a little background on myself. First of all, you can connect with me or follow me on Twitter at Brian Kafferke. I'm also on LinkedIn, so feel free to connect that way. I love to network and connect with people. You can always send questions through there. I'm a Microsoft Technical Solutions professional fairly recently. Prior to that, I was a consultant and Microsoft MVP. I have decades of IT experience. Also the author of Pro PowerShell for Database Developers, and I lead the SQL PaaS chapter, the Rhode Island Microsoft Business Intelligence User Group, and the Rhode Island Southern New England R User Group. Several places to the slides, I have the link to where you can find the slide presentation of this, as well as the code sample, and that's at the bottom, so it's on GitHub. It's you can search, of course, for my name, Brian Kafferke, or B Kafferke, and go under there. It's under a shared area, and you can find it there. And I do want to do a little bit of a promotion. We are having chairing an event, SQL Saturday, which is part of SQL PaaS or SQL PaaS, which is an international organization. They have these all over the world at different times. And they are one-day technical events with multiple tracks, so you can focus on whatever you particularly are interested in, whether it's analytics or database performance tuning or whatever is your thing. So it's going to be on December 9th. It's in Northern Rhode Island in a town called Smithfield, which is just over the border. So it's only about 35 minutes outside of Boston, easily commutable from anywhere in Massachusetts, Rhode Island, really Connecticut, anywhere in New England should be pretty easy to get to. We even have people I know coming from Albany area and things like that. So that's go to the link there at sqlsaturday.com 694 event home. You can always search for SQL Saturday Providence, and you can also find it that way if you don't have this link. Also, we're going to be doing a full day of data science with R training called Data Science with R from A to Z. That's going to be in Franklin, Massachusetts, so it's even closer to the Boston area. It's about 30 minutes from Boston. Very easy to get to from Worcester area, anywhere in New Hampshire, certainly anywhere in Rhode Island. So it's a really nice location. If you're familiar with Foxborough Stadium or the Wrentham Outlets are, really close to that. So that gives you kind of an idea where it is. You can register for that on Eventbrite, rprogramming.eventbrite. So r_programming.eventbrite.com. If you do go there, please use the discount code Microsoft, which will give you 20% off. And that's a really great deal because we're going to be, first of all, it's only $150 maximum cost with 20% off. I guess it'd be somewhere around $120. And we're going to be giving everybody a copy of the book, The Art of R Programming. That's the cover. You can actually see that symbol comes from that book. And we're going to be providing lunch as well as coffee, snacks, etc. So for essentially $120, you get a full day of training. You get a free book, which is about a $40 value right there. And you're also getting lunch and things. So you're really getting an awesome deal. So I think it's a no-brainer to go to that if you are all interested in data science and R. And I would point out that you may have heard of languages like Python and SAS and other languages which do data science. Whether you want to use some of those other languages or not, I highly recommend people start with R because it's really, I think, the easiest language to start doing data science with. That's my personal professional opinion. So let's talk about what a package is, because the way we can use SQL with R is to install a package. And what a package is, it's a library of functions. If you've used Python, you know it also uses modules. PowerShell uses modules. C#, DLLs, dynamic link libraries. And the idea is you just have a function library you bring in and it adds new commands to the language. Now, the nice thing about it is these are all open source community developed packages, these libraries. And so they have thousands of them. They do all kinds of things. And one of them is the one we're going to talk about here, which is SQLDF. Now, these are downloaded from repositories. And another nice thing about R, which makes it really easy to start with, is there's really the core guardian of the R language. There's a single place where you normally would get R, which is from CRAN, the Comprehensive R Archive Network. And they not only maintain the basic R language and versions, but they also maintain most of the packages that you would want to use and provide some level of quality control over them. Now, again, the link below, you'll see that again, is where you can get the slides and code sample. The code I am presenting is as is, not intended for production use. So, you know, it's really meant just to demonstrate and inform. So please don't try to copy it and put it right into use. And if there's any credentialing, I don't have any in my code, but if there is anything, I warn you, do not put passwords and things in any kind of code because it's what they call clear text, easy to be able to get, and then you have a security issue. Now, there's two steps to using any package. First, you have to download and install a package on your system. That makes sense. It's kind of like anytime you would use any new program. If you wanted to use Word or PowerPoint or something, you would download, install it, and then when you want to use it, you load it into memory, right? And that's what you do here. So once you've installed it, we can use the library statement or the require statement to bring it into memory. Little tidbit. The difference between library versus require, if you've seen them in R, is require is really more intended for in-stream script loading of libraries, and it returns a sort of check true false that you can use to see if it succeeded in loading the package, whereas the normal library statement doesn't do that. Now you can use RStudio to install a package, or you can use the install.packages function. But if you use RStudio, this slide just shows you how to get there and what to do. It's really a nice feature, very easy to do. And using R to install packages, you just use the install.packages statement as shown in the first code sample there. And if you want to install, now by default, when you install a package, it automatically goes to CRAN, as I mentioned. If you do want to use some packages from other places, such as GitHub, then you need to install a package which is available on CRAN called DevTools. Then you can use the statement library DevTools as shown, and then you can use other repositories such as GitHub as shown here. And you have all these other possible functions which are extended from that DevTools, allowing you to install from other repositories. Now, the SQLDF package, let's talk about that. SQL, obviously, in the name stands for Structured Query Language, and the DF stands for Data Frame. The way R stores internal tables or tables in memory is called a data frame. So it's just a two-dimensional storage of a table. If you've used any, if you ever loaded record sets and things from using SQL, then you're manipulating an in-memory table once you've retrieved it. So an in-memory table, again, kind of redundant here, but an in-memory table in R is called a data frame. And typically when you load anything in, whether it's from a CSV file or from a database, it will put it into a memory object, and that's the data frame, and we can manipulate that. However, normally we would have to use specific packages and functions that R uses to manipulate data frames. But if we use the SQLDF package, we can use native SQL, SQLite compatible SQL or SQL to manipulate it. And I do say SQL and SQL interchangeably. I tend to use SQL. That's really, people who use databases tend to use the word SQL as a quick way to say SQL, but it's the same thing. The nice thing about using SQL is it's easy to use and understand as a language in its own right. And if you already know SQL, well, then you have a really big jump on doing data wrangling in R. You can save yourself some work upfront and get in and stop being productive right away. So it's great for DBAs, database developers, or anybody who already knows SQL. And as I mentioned, it does rely on SQLite. So let's get in and let's do a little demo. So let me start R. I think I already have the script ready to run here, so it's probably going to bring everything in for me. Okay, here we are. SQL DF, SQL DF. All right, so again, disclaimer to protect myself from liability. This code is not intended for use, it's just demonstration. So I encourage you to look at it and everything, but just be careful whenever you run any code that you don't do anything you wouldn't want to do in your production environments. Now, one thing we can do is use this function, install.packages, to see what's already installed on the system. And this gives me a list of all the different things. You can also go to your Packages tab, again, if you're in RStudio, and this will show you all the packages available. And I can bring any one of them in by just checkbox, and it does a library statement and brings it in for me. Or I can just use a library statement. Now, the Package tab, do not be fooled, is not meant to install new packages. It's meant to just load ones in that you already have on your computer. If we want to install a package, we can use the install.packages function, as shown here, and this will actually install SQLDF, and it goes automatically to CRAN. You don't have to tell it. It's one of the things I really like, and it's, again, one of the reasons why it's easier to start with R, because in Python, you have to usually know where you're going, and there's different ways to bring in new modules and packages. So now, if we want to know a little about a new package, such as SQLDF, we can use this function package description, and it lists in the console below. Gives us a nice little description of the package. Now, if you're getting, different packages have different levels of documentation available, and you're in luck with SQLDF because it's really well documented. So I can use the help statement on SQLDF and go here. And when I do the help, let me just probably need to load that in first. So let me bring in SQLDF. And you notice it's loading other packages. Those are called dependencies or dependent packages. Okay, so you do have to have the package loaded to get help. That makes sense. And you can see in the help window here, we get all kinds of help. First thing, it shows all the different options for running things. And it's really easy. We won't be using most of the options because we just want to show how you can do a SQL statement. There are ways to make this also point directly to a database such as Postgres or MySQL. But I would probably favor doing something more direct and bring it in. But you can do that. I'm going to do a demonstration at the end on pulling data from SQL Server. But you can see all this great stuff. One thing I would point out to you that's kind of nice is at the end, somewhere in here, give you a lot of code examples. And there is a link right here. You can get what they call the deck of information. And this is, so there's examples in GitHub you can also get, some of which I did take here, so credit that. If I have anything in here, hopefully I do mock it. But so great stuff. So let's start in. So we already brought in SQLDF, and I'm going to bring in another package I had to install, which you saw the example on the slide from GitHub called baby names. And it's just a cute thing, gives us a little list of baby names. So if you're expecting, this might be a good one you want to look at for considering popularity of baby names. If I use the head statement, that'll give me a nice sample of the data so I can see different examples here. And you can see this goes back a ways, so what was popular over 100 years ago. And if I use the str, then I will get the structure of the data. So this is a nice way to get a little description and get a sense of what data is in there. So let's start in. Now baby names, but the very fact that I loaded the package baby names automatically comes with that data frame. So I can use the data frame just like this, just as I would any other SQL table. Now this happens to be something that's loaded for me, so I can just say I want to load everything, asterisks from baby names, where the year is greater than 2000. And I can use the limit statement, which is kind of handy if you've got a big data set and you just want to test things out first. And so if I do that, it will come back and it will list out the data. So it's great that way, really handy. Now if I store that in a variable, I could go over here, for instance, you can see some of these things. And you do get this little nice little grid. So so you can do that also. If I did something like my data, just to kind of demonstrate that, I could do something like that. And my data comes up and then I can browse it and sort it and things with a nice little utility there. All right, so what else can we do with this? What kind of SQL is supported? Because if you know SQL, you know that oftentimes there's variations in different syntax for SQL. Sometimes there's limitations. So one thing we can see is that I can do select, I can do aggregation functions. And I can do obviously that in the group by. So this is an example of doing aggregation. Again, I encourage you to look at the examples, but it's a pretty rich implementation of SQL. So if you use SQLite, it's pretty good. It's pretty extensive. But take a look and see what you need. And I'm going to do an example here where I want to create a sort of temporary table, which I'm going to use to translate M and F to male and female. And so I'm going to do that and put it in a data frame, which is called reference underscore sex. Let me put it in there. And you can see it's on the right. It popped up. It's now there. And now what I want to do, I was really just doing that so I can do a join. So I can say, now I'm going to join on that. And I'm going to use the column that has the sex MRF. And I'm going to join to this. And I want to get the name pulled in. And if I run that, you can see it did. It kind of wraps it in this, but you can see that it puts the name translated F to female and things. All right. Now this, again, I did take out of the documentation, which is actually quite good for SQLDF. And we can see I'm doing a more complex thing. I'm doing a selecting and I'm doing subselects, which is pretty cool. If you've ever done them, they're very handy. Doing grouping. So I'm doing quite a bit here. And this one is using a different data set or data frame, which is called Iris. So Iris, if I just highlight that and run it, you get a listing of Iris. And it's basically plant data. It's used a lot in presentations and demos because it's built into R. So I'm going to run this query just to give you an idea of what it can do. And it gave me a nice little summary at the end of like the average sepal lengths and petal lengths. And sepal is the leaf underneath the blossom. That's what that is. Okay. So we can also do something like this where we can, I'm just going to do, this case it's a CSV file. Okay, so I need to load the CSV file. So to load a file, I can either load it with the load CSV statement, and I do have it loaded here, but I do want to demonstrate this. I can import a data set. This is really handy. So I'm going to say I want to import from text. I can go from Excel. I can go from a number of things. And I'll go here just, I have one here somewhere. And like if I want to load, for instance, sales, I can load it like that. And what a handy little utility. So I got to give them credit for this. It's pretty cool. So I can say I want to call this sales new. I'll call it just sales. I can say what kind of encoding. Does it have a heading? And if it has a heading, it will use those for column names. Do you have row names? So R supports row names, and that means you get like a, it's like a primary clustering key kind of thing, just a name for each row. And you can tell it like what delimits it, etc. And it look, you can see a little thing here. It tells you it already figured out pretty much how to load this. I can just say import, and it shows you the data that imported, and it's right there. So isn't that very cool? I like that a lot. So it's a very handy thing, this import data set. It's good to explore what you can do within RStudio because there are a lot of nice features. And I will point out there's also RTools Visual Studio, which is another alternate IDE for R. And I think R Visual Studio is much better suited for operationalizing your R scripts if you want to put them into production, turn them into jobs that can execute and things. And especially if you're integrating with things like Azure and SQL Server and things, it's got a lot of nice features for that. But if you're just exploring data, I do like RStudio for that. It's kind of more of like a playing around kind of space where you get a lot of nice visibility. All right, back to our program. So now I want to show using SQLDF with SQL Server data. So I'm a big SQL Server person. I owe most of my career to SQL Server, so very near and dear to my heart. An easy way to connect and pull data out of not only SQL Server, pretty much any database, is using ODBC. And so the library for that or the package is called RODBC. You probably won't have it offhand. Use the methods again from the tools menu or whatever you choose. Install .packages function and just bring it in. So I'm going to bring it. I have it. I'm just going to load into memory. And then what I want to do is I want to create a connection. Now, typically what I do is I'll write a function for this that I can make it either connect using integrated security, which means it just uses my Windows credentials, or passing a user ID and password. So here I'm spelling it out though, so you can see what I'm doing. And so I'm using the ODBC driver connect, and I tell it what server I want to connect to, local, what's the database, and it's a trusted connection. So it's not asking me for my ID and things because I'm already logged into Windows. So that's kind of a nice feature. It's really a nice feature actually of SQL Server that you can do that because you don't have to pass credentials around, which I really like, especially for demos like this. And one of the things I can do now is I can use the SQL columns function, which is part of that ODBC, and it tells me what the columns are in this particular table, sales credit card. And what I'm going to do now, just to demonstrate, how would I use SQLDF with SQL Server? And I guess I should start with why would I want to? Let me fix this, do a query. The reason I would want to do this is, very often you're going to have a lot of data in the database, and when you query directly from a SQL Server database, whether it's on-premise or in the cloud, they call that a round trip. And it puts a strain on the server, and if you're just querying the same data a lot, it would be much better to pull the data you want into memory, into a data frame, and then do whatever you want with it and play with it. And maybe even if you really need to use it long term and things, you could save it into an R data set or just put into a CSV. And you're just lightening the load on the server. You don't want to keep running queries over the wire and put stress on the server if you don't need to. Especially if it's a big query, it takes a while to run. You definitely don't want to do it. So as a demonstration, I'm going to create this a sales SQL, and I'm going to do my SQL query. Now this is using ODBC, using the connection, so it's going to connect to my local server on my machine. And so this is actually going to SQL Server. So let me run this query to get my data frame. And I can see it here. It probably already was there. I just kind of recreated it. But you can see here, sales SQL, and I can use this to sort and do things with it. Now what I want to do is I'm going to use SQLDF. Notice it's always SQLDF. And then I can just run my query, and I'm going to be querying from sales SQL. So again, the from statement is always referring to a data frame name. So you can load it. And so in this case, we created one by pulling data out of SQL Server, and now we can run a query against it. And it's kind of handy, again, because it can save resources. So I think this is a great way to blend the ODBC connection and SQL Server retrieval, etc., with SQLDF. There's a little bit better integration, admittedly, if you're doing using SQLDF with Postgres or MySQL, but I actually kind of like this method because then you're always disconnecting and not going on round trips so to the database. All right, so I do want to, before I wrap things up, I do want to highlight something. As a Microsoft employee now and working on Azure products, I am extremely impressed and amazed actually by Azure, and I want to point out that there's many different places within the Azure Cloud Services where you can use R in different ways, and that the great thing I like about it is you can use the level of performance and extensibility you need. So if you need to scale up really big, you can do that. If you want to just run, you know, you don't need the scale, that's fine. So you can run all the way from just the way you would on-prem using a client machine, which doesn't scale very well, but you can do that if you're using very small data sets, to using our SQL Server integration, which will allow you to actually run as a server. You run our server, and it actually scales up. It runs parallel mode. It will make maximum use of CPUs, and it can page in and out big data into memory, so paging out of memory as needed to do work on a data set. So that will scale you up fairly large, and if you really need to go to really big data, then you can use things like Azure Data Lakes, and Azure ML Studio will let you also connect through to that. And it's even got things like Jupyter Notebooks called Azure Notebooks to let you do some, you know, a lot of playing around and exploring and still being able to access big data like Spark or Hadoop or any of those things you want to do. So a lot of good things there, and I'm sure I'll be doing presentations on that coming up, but I did want to kind of plug a little for that because I think it's just really cool stuff and a very good place. I think Azure is the best place to be if you're going to be doing a lot with R. All right, so wrapping up. SQLDF adds structured query language support to your R scripts, which is really nice. So if you already know SQL, I think it's a great way to just jump in and stop playing with that because you can do a lot. When I first started with R, that's kind of how I got going, and I was able to join, filter, do some queries, and I was able to produce some results quickly and, you know, kind of make the customers, users, or your boss happy early on without having to say, well, wait, I need to learn how to use dplyr, and I'm trying to learn how to use all these different ways of piping data around. Admittedly, I think this method is good, but there are some more efficient ways when you get more up to speed on R, like dplyr is a really great way to query data, and there's different packages out there, but this is a great way to get started. All right, again, thank you. Please follow me or subscribe to my channel because I do a lot of work with this, and I'm going to be doing all kinds of training. And again, please look to the, if you're at all looking to get up to speed on data science, absolutely you want to be coming to the class in Franklin, Massachusetts on December 8th, which is only a week away from the recording of this. It's going to be awesome. And again, there's free book, free food, all that stuff is all part included in the price, which is really cheap. And you want to use the code Microsoft. So again, hope to see you there and see you in my next presentation. Thank you.